Now, how do we diagnose COPD? Well, we're going to get a really complete history of symptoms from the patient. We might do some pulmonary function tests that give us specific numbers on how well the patient's able to breathe. We also might look at a CAT scan or a chest X-ray. Now, how would we look at this progressive decline? Well, we talked about pulmonary function tests. Now, you see them there with a clip on their nose, and they have that mouthpiece in their mouth, and it's attached to a piece of equipment. So a pulmonary function test, these are breathing tests that they perform before and after a bronchodilator. So they'll do the test, then they'll give a patient a bronchodilator that's inhaled, and now they'll figure out if the airflow limitation is present and or partially or fully reversible. Remember, that's a criteria we talked about earlier. So we're looking at pulmonary function tests. You do them first, then you give the patient an inhaled bronchodilator, then you measure again. That'll help us know if the airflow limitation is present and if it's partially or fully reversible with a bronchodilator. Now, spirometry measures the ratio of the amount of forced expiratory volume in 1 second, and that's forced vital capacity. So you divide the forced expiratory volume divided by the forced vital capacity, that'll give us a percentage. So that's what we're looking at, that percentage number. So in a pulmonary function test, we're gonna end up with that percentage that gives us an indication of the patient's overall status. So FEV divided by FCC gives us a percentage. A baseline is important, and then we consistently check in back with the patient to see how they're progressing. Are they getting better, or are they going through that anticipated progressive decline that we're trying to prevent? Now, a CAT scan or a chest X-ray are two examples of imaging that we use when diagnosing COPD. A chest X-ray will help us rule out other diseases, like maybe the patient has lung cancer, bronchiectasis, maybe pleural disease, or interstitial lung disease, or even heart failure. So if this patient's having shortness of breath, those are other things that we would consider as differential diagnoses, and we'd want to rule them out. Chest X-ray would help that. That'll also help us identify complications of COPD. So we want to make sure that, do they have a pneumonia or not? Do they have a pneumothorax and air in there that has caused collapse of a lung, or are they in heart failure? So chest X-ray can help us rule out other causes, or it might help us identify complications of COPD. You notice that some of the things are the same in both lists. That's why it's never just a whoop, one test and we know what's what it is. You have to look at all the pieces of information to put together the puzzle to figure out the underlying cause of the patient's respiratory problems. Now, ABGs and COPD, what would you expect? Well, usually you'll see a mild to moderate COPD usually shows moderate hypoxemia without any hypercapnia. Now, if we didn't use those words, what does hypoxemia mean? Hypo means low, emia is in the blood, so we're looking at ox in the middle, that's oxygen. So low oxygen in the blood without hyper-elevated capnia, meaning CO2. So with mild to moderate COPD, we normally see moderate low oxygen without elevated CO2. Now, as COPD progresses, you're more likely to see an elevated CO2 level, which we call hypercapnia. Now, ABGs are often worse with an exacerbation, right? So, or with exertion. So if the patient's just had a lot of activity, then it's gonna be worse. If they've had an exacerbation of COPD, those are also gonna be worse. But it's always a good idea, because ABGs only show you, boom, what was going on at that exact moment that you drew that arterial blood gas sample. That's what the ABG tells you. It's a good idea to look at trends. Do you have other values? Do you have trends of before and after treatment? Those are critically important things to help you put that whole puzzle together.